or the where the hell is everybody conundrum. But where is everybody? This was Fermi's question in 1950. If there are other civilizations, how come we haven't heard from them yet? The arguments for and against this are legion. They're fun to read, but ultimately they're all supposition. The question came up in casual conversation one day between Fermi and Teller and another group of physicists about the absence of evidence of extraterrestrial life when the estimates were so high. Enrico Fermi, of course, is the brilliant physicist who was behind the first controlled nuclear reaction. He was a champion bread slicer, and he also conducted nuclear experiments with the cooperation of some local goldfish, making him the first trans-species physicist. Edward Teller, the father of the hydrogen bomb, was, of course, a man with the attitude of, if I have a hammer, everything looks like a nail. He recommended hydrogen bombs for everything. Little known about him was he was the inheritor in trust of Groucho Marx's eyebrows. Many years later, Drake was like, hey, I'm bothered by this conversation. Can't we turn it into a formulation? And Drake jotted down an equation that I think is grossly misunderstood by the public. He wanted to say, what would be the actual chances of us finding life, and he invented its formula with seven terms that is often discussed on the internet. And many people have problems with the terms in the equation. You can go over the Drake equation yourself. I'm just planning to tackle one of these assumptions in the Fermi problem that I think is misunderstood completely, and I'm going to launch into a long-winded thesis. The most recognized flaw in the Drake equation is that all the terms are unknown. The values we input into the equation are speculation. There's no way to get the values other than to go out and get them. Two of the terms in the equation, we are sort of getting the idea of the answers, the rate of star formation and the stars that have planets, but the rest of the numbers are all make-believe. In fact, three of them at least aren't even defined or are completely unknowable. The average number of planets that can potentially support life, well, that means life as we know it. And one of the common misconceptions in science fiction is that everywhere you go in this galaxy or the other, everything has DNA. There's this assumption that there's no other form of life but DNA. You find rock monsters in SETI Alpha 6, they have DNA, it's silicon-based and it's a triple helix, but it's still DNA. There's no evidence that that's the only way life could form. It's the only kind of life we could look for. So as we discover these planets, all we can do is find the Goldilocks planets that could support us. And the other two, there's just no way of knowing until we go out there and actually get the answer. There's no predictive power on a probability formula until you populate your probabilities, which means you gotta go to another place and find the life. Even species and civilizations, I have a problem with that term, because there's an expectation that we're going to find like one smart species per planet, and like those on Earth, they're going to work together in societies and civilizations with some common purpose and technology. And is that really guaranteed? That's the only way life arises? So you can see the problem with the equation. It has a lot of unknowns in it, but I have a much larger problem with it. It's not Drake, it's what people do with the Drake equation that is the problem. This is not physics, it's a probabilistic formula, not theoretical, based on observation. That is, there is no fundamental principle operating behind it. Look at this term, for example, the fraction of those stars that have planets. Well, what decides if a star has planets? The star itself, Newton's law of gravitation, electrostatic laws, electromagnetic forces, stellar winds, particle density, nature of particles, cats and dogs, oh my. All of this will play into planetary formation. None of these fundamental laws are in that term. It is simply a probability. It does not have an explanation from existing laws. Let's contrast it to F equals minus kx, Hooke's law, which predicts and models the forces on a spring. It will produce values for you that originally came from observation, and you can follow it down to the molecular forces underlying it. Probability equations don't know why it is happening. The classic kinematics equation of motion, the horror of students across the planet, D equals D naught plus VIT plus half AT squares, models accelerating objects, and we can keep adding terms. We can do 1/6 JT cubed for the jerk term, and there is a measurement called the jerk. Each term in this formula has a physical meaning that I can explain and measure and understand. It isn't chance. It is a concept described mathematically. Position, speed, acceleration, and jerkiness. No term in the Drake equation has a meaning in this manner. We can look at another weakness of a probability formula versus a physical constant formula. This has implications for what we can do with a probability formula. By assuming a probabilistic approach, there will be no way of fine-tuning our search because there could be fundamental laws underlying it that we won't discover. Perhaps life has a structure in the galaxy. It follows stellar winds or interstellar objects. There may be forces that strictly control where life can occur while we are using a probability, a random method of searching. The beauty of having a fundamental formula to guide you where you think you've discovered a pattern in the universe is it can give you an expectation of range of values that guides your experimental designs and your investigations. If we look at Hooke's law of elastic force, we can write the deflection on a scale, x, is equal to the force you apply to the scale divided by the stiffness, that k value. Let's suppose we build a spring scale with 300 newtons per meter stiffness. This means it's going to take you a 30 kilogram pull to stretch it a meter. And we decide to place a 5 newton apple on the scale. That's 500 grams. And of course it has to be an apple because it's newton. We would expect a deflection of 1.6 centimeters. Well, if you look at the spring scale from old house there, 1.6 centimeter deflection would be just nice. Like, we go like, oh, I could read that on that scale. Look at that. That apple will easily deflect that scale and I could read it. And I said, well, we need to weigh some grapes. Then you can look at this rule and go, no, grape's not even going to register on this scale. Give me a minute with my calculator and I'll tell you how big of a scale we're going to need and the spring coefficient, the stiffness that we're going to need to actually make a successful measurement. You can't do that with a probability formula, really. Science is beautiful. There is such majesty in investigating nature and looking at things and realizing our mind can comprehend stuff. And we can't have that in teaching. We need to beat that out of a student. We need to make them realize that life is drudgery. And the way science teachers contribute to that is repeating the measurements. We over and over again repeat the measurement till we've beaten all curiosity out of the students. Gets you ready for adulthood. If we repeat measurements time and time again, we're hoping that we will converge on the truthful answer that we couldn't find with one measurement. For example, when I was a child, I had a teacher that used to say, "Can't you guys do any work than counting the holes in the ceiling tiles?" That was his accusation of staring up at the ceiling tiles. Now, I know the cell phone generation knows nothing about that. Looking down is what you do. But I was accused of counting the holes in the ceiling tile. So when I became a teacher, it suddenly occurred to me, wait a moment, let's move this from a metaphor, and I'll make the students count the holes in the ceiling tiles. Over the years, I would have the students estimate how many holes were actually in the acoustic tiles on the ceiling of my classroom. Alas, after my heart attack, when I came back to work, my little binder with the data was gone. But we'd been collecting this data for 30 years, and it was converging on a number. That's a really good sign that you're getting closer and closer to the truth. I probably could have actually counted them in that time, but the number was like a couple hundred thousand. But I took a metaphor and turned it into an experiment. It was really beautiful. But what happens if your data starts to do this? You repeat the measurement over and over and over again, and you start getting wider and wider and wider values. That's a real bad sign. Something's going on that you just can't keep averaging. It's not correlating correctly. There's something weird going on. You got to look for that kind of pattern. The Drake equation can trick you into believing it's converging on an estimate when it's not. What I did is I took the Drake equation and I input variables randomly. A through G on the screen here is the seven terms in the Drake equation. And I put in random numbers. What you're seeing on the graph, the red dots, are column A. That's clearly random. The blue dots are the result of multiplying the seven random numbers together. You can see they rapidly converge on the number one. It's actually zero. I deliberately added one to the distribution to lift the line off the axes. Seven random variables can be put into the Drake equation and it will stabilize to an answer of no civilizations in the universe. But it doesn't mean that. This is an artifact of seven random terms. This is all seven random terms, plotted as the colored dots. Totally random input variables produced a stable output variable. The histograms on the left show the histogram of column A. 1,000 random numbers, the occurrence of each number between 0 and 1 is pretty close to even, but the answer, when you multiply seven random numbers together, the spread for the Drake equation, you can see that histogram, it generates almost the same number. This does not happen at all if you use a formula underlying these variables. I'll show you another little trick here. I took Newton's law, F equals ma, and I input random numbers. The mass and the acceleration were completely random here. So when I plot them against each other, you can see it's just scattered dots. However, running them through the formula, when I plot force against mass, you see the pattern developing. Even though acceleration is messing the numbers up, it's not enough. 1,000 times, you can see that force is correlating to mass, and force also correlates to acceleration. With only two terms in the formula and the law of nature tying them together, it would be pretty easy to spot that even with random numbers, your answers aren't really random. There's an underlying pattern. Seven random variables? Forget it. Seven random variables in a formula can trick you into thinking that the estimate is stabilizing. You can't be using a formula when you don't know what the numbers are, especially with seven terms. Basic Newton's law only depends on two terms. The patterns will emerge in that case. You could just be randomly applying them. It's going to show up. But fundamentally, Newton's law is very different from a probability of formula because two of the terms are physical quantities of the universe that we can measure anytime, anywhere. There's no uncertainty about them. Acceleration and mass are physical properties that can be measured, and this would allow us to systematically test a variety of actual values experimentally determined, and we would discover the underlying relationship because it's built into the universe we live in. No one has advanced so far in physics or any science to have an equation that says, the formula for a planet equals 10,000 kilograms of rock plus 3 frog's tails plus 7 newts times Maxwell's equations divided by... No, we don't have a formula for those. Ultimately, the Drake equation is not an answer to anything. The Drake equation is a question. It's trying to bring some sense of quantitative, a numbers game, to a question that is very vague. Fermi's question was general purpose. Drake tried to quantify it. Drake knows his equation is not an answer, but I think the public doesn't know that. They think somehow it's controlling the universe. It is not. It's our best guess about the things we would have to learn if we want to answer the question. Let's go back to the Fermi paradox now. Many estimates using the Drake equation or other methods seem to generate a high probability of life, yet we never detect any. So if more and more planets are known every day, and more observatories keep scanning the sky, then why are we met with silence? now the fun begins. Why don't we find ETIs? When I was a child, there was a single suspected extrasolar planet around Barnard Star. Now the rate of discovery has exploded. It's important to recognize that these planets were always there. It's not like we just discovered them and they came into existence and therefore they haven't had time to communicate with us. We're now learning the universe is really swarming with planets, which makes the Fermi paradox even worse. Here's a partial list of reasons why we don't find life. You can go through them. You could write books on this. I'm uninterested in recapitulating ground that has already been covered. I do find of interest that it might be the nature of intelligent life to destroy others. Everyone is listening, but no one is transmitting. Communication is always dangerous. We can encapsulate these in the term the dark forest. And rather than spend a lot of time discussing the dark forest, let's have John Cleese explain to us this hypothesis.
In this picture, there are 47 people. None of them can be seen. In this film, we hope to show you how not to be seen. This is Mr. E. R. Bradshaw of Napier Court, Black Lion Road, London, SE14. He cannot be seen. Now, I'm going to ask him to stand up. Mr. Bradshaw, will you stand up, please? This demonstrates the value of not being seen. In this picture, we cannot see Mrs. B. J. Smegma of 13, The Crescent, Belmont. Mrs. Smegma, will you stand up, please? This is Mr. Nesbitt of Harlow, Newtown. Mr. Nesbitt, will you stand up, please? Mr. Nesbitt has learned the first lesson of not being seen, not to stand up. However, he has chosen a very obvious piece of cover.
Now that we're back, the one I want to tackle is civilizations only broadcast detectable signals for a brief period of time. Variations on this involve the silent Earth hypothesis. This one has been coming up for decades now, but it is demonstrably false. I believe the anchoring effect is causing what seems to be a plausible hypothesis to be repeated so often it is accepted as truth. And there's a lot of these out there. The first time I came across it was in the book Yes, We Have No Neutrons by A.K. Dewdney and his criticism of SETI, the Search for Extraterrestrial Life. And it has been repeated since then. Now, I love A.K. Dewdney. I read a lot of his stuff. Very eye-opening, particularly Planiverse. I highly recommend as reading. But it is now accepted as truth that we're falling silent. And this is going to be my thesis now. I'm going to beat this sucker to death. We are, in fact, getting louder all the time. Common misconception is that we have built cable systems to replace transmitters, and this is completely false. Cables started in 1850. There were already transatlantic cables, closing on 200 years ago now. We didn't replace radio station with cables, we switched cable for cable. Here's the London Telegraph Station in about 1900. These people are communicating via wires across the ocean into the farthest corners of the empire. By 1902, there was now trans-Pacific telegraph cables. And by 1964, there were telephone lines across the Pacific, undersea. I remember being stunned as a child when I heard the first via satellite transmission. I'd been with my mother when she made some overseas phone calls, and it was an amazing collection of trunk noises and switching centers, and when the first via satellite transmissions came on, it was really cool. The first fax machine to be able to transmit images was built by Giovanni Caselli, and it was used in France in the 1860s briefly, but got destroyed in the Franco-Prussian War in 1870, and this led the French to make sure the Germans never touched France ever again. Going to the 20th century, telex. This was the early text messaging system that started in the 1930s and it continued to the 1980s. I remember my sister putting messages through on this system when I was a boy in the 1970s, and it got as far along as this before it slowly fell to the backwaters in terms of the internet. My point is this. From 1850 to about 1970, the world was already awash in analog and digital systems that spanned the planet. It was radio that took over from these systems, and only partially. And the wave of switching to cable since the mid-1980s is simply the replacement of old copper wire telegraph system with fiber optics. There has been no great silencing as a result. It's not completely true for consumer radio and television that we'll see in a minute. Cable TV, the switch from broadcast in-home entertainment to cable sources, seems to be the impetus to believe that we are falling silent. However, the transmitters still exist, even if you no longer tune into them, and it's also true of radio. While affluent countries are seeing a switch from terrestrial radio to streaming, there are many powerful transmitters for AM and FM radio being built around the world. Even the US still has more than 250 50 kilowatt AM radio stations alone. True, there are only two radio transmitters greater than 1 megawatt left, down from more than 20, but there are more 2 to 400 kilowatt transmitters than ever. But our strongest and most consistent signals have never been commercial radio. Now, if we look at over-the-air transmission of TV in the U.S., there are 5,000 full-power TV transmitters in the USA functioning at the 1 megawatt class, and 2,000 more low-power transmitters. And I counted them. I used the FCC's database to get that. There's a lot of broadcast TV stations still out there. Kossuth Radio in Budapest has been broadcasting since 1925 and has currently got a 2-megawatt transmitter with 47 repeater stations. And NBC, during the pandemic, actually has added more radio stations in Papua New Guinea, and many island nations are using radio because there are simply too many islands to span with cable and the cost. Cell phone towers I'll toss in, but I don't expect them to be much. There are about 5 million cell phone towers worldwide. The maximum power is 500 watts per transmitter. So if we take half of that, you know, it gives us about a gigawatt of transmission power, but it's not a coordinated signal. They'll be radiating over top of each other. There'll be constructive and destructive interference. It's not worth tossing them in. I got more than enough evidence otherwise. Governments, more than 40 time radio stations worldwide are maintained by them. 10 of them are transmitting at higher than 300 kilowatts, and several Russian and Chinese time bases are nearly 1 megawatt, and these are clockwork precision radio transmissions, and they've been going on for a very long time. Navy communications, especially for subs, uses the VLF frequencies, and they are multiple megawatt transmitters, and they've been in use since the 1950s. Now, VLF doesn't get out of the atmosphere as good as some of the others, but it still gets out of the atmosphere. Weather radar. There are more than 160 S-band weather radar stations in the U.S. With Canada thrown in, that's nearly 200 radar stations at around 700 kilowatts each. Up in the Arctic, the tinfoil hat people are pleased to see the High Frequency Active Auroral Research Program, and it's a 3.76 megawatt transmitter with about 5 gigawatts effective radiated power, which is more than enough to boil the head of the tinfoil hat people. there are several of these stations around the planet blasting away to excite the ionosphere and beyond. Russia's equivalent was running at up to 250 megawatts effective radiated power. Because they're Russians. The SuperDarn network, they're much smaller, but there are 36 sites at about 8 kilowatts that help us research where the aurora is and make sure our satellites and people in space are safe. You can see this on spaceweather.com and look at the auroral imagery that is picked up by people when the system alerts them to auroras. This means space is brimming with signals. Up, down, left, right, all over the place. We're just screaming out radio signals to space. The European Incoherent Scatter Scientific Association maintains several radio dishes running in and up to 2 megawatts transmission. And that's about the same range that a lot of primary airport systems are working at. The dew line in World War II and through the Cold War was the alert stations in northern Canada. They've been replaced by the North Warning Station, and there's about 50 radar sites, most of them in Canada, that are about 24 kilowatts. They're much lower power than the old dew system because we're more efficient with how we conduct our radar, change the way we transmit it, but they're upgrading the system yet again. The Russian has a system of unknown power that has a 3,000 kilometer range, and it was built in 2019. 1 megawatt is the best I've been able to find. The Russians are kind of mum about it. We have missile warning systems being built around the world. The ones the U.S. has and in England, they're running about 700 kilowatts per face. Russia has the 1 megawatt one. There's a pile of these just blasting away, watching for missiles. The stations in Russia, Daryal, is at 50 megawatts, and they're planning to go to 300 megawatts with 7 stations. But at this point in time, only 2 are operating. These are the most powerful radars ever invented. The Cobra Dane radar system, which can go up to 16 megawatts, has now been reattached to Space Force, and it's currently running around 700 kilowatts to 1400 megawatts scanning space for potentially hazardous space debris, mostly of human origin, near-Earth orbit stuff, but it can scan all the way out to geosynchronous at a minimum. Because of our increasing realization of how dangerous space could be, we now have an entire planetary defense network, largely run by the Americans, but it spans the globe and scanning for debris out there, and the systems are getting bigger all the day. The basic science of learning about space and the planetary defense are inseparable because we have curiosity and we also realize things could be very dangerous. Right now, the U.S. Space Surveillance Network has over 30 ground-based radars, but there's so much overlap of other systems, I'm going to inevitably wind up mixing some of these up because there's a whole plethora of institutions in the United States that have their fingers in this pie, and it's very difficult to keep everything separate when I go through it. The Eglin Air Force Base currently has a 30 megawatt radar that is now also dedicated to planetary defense. Space Force has installed a 1 to 3 megawatt system on Kwajalein Atoll, and they're scanning space with that. DARC is the Deep Space Advanced Radar concept, and 3 planetary radar installations are being tendered to able to reach geosynchronous altitudes, which is twice the range of the existing radars. Radar astronomy is a separate field where we use radar to just scan the heavens. Right now, they're running at about 50 kilowatts, so not even remotely competitive with the defensive radar systems that are being established, but the radar astronomy is being planned for bigger and bigger and bigger things. China just completed its FAST radio telescope, replacing Arecibo. It is the largest single walk ever made on planet Earth. And it cannot transmit, but it can receive. And there are plans to create multi-megawatt transmitters. This is called bistatic radar, where someone else will send up the signal and the fast telescope will receive it. The SKA, or Square Kilometer Array, is being built, and it will be the largest array of radio telescopes ever made. And again, it cannot transmit, but they're gonna build transmitters, and this will become the biggest listening post ever, and we'll be pinging space, and they will be receiving. They're gonna have dense aperture array of like solid receiving material. They're gonna have the sparse aperture array, and even this offset Gregorian array, and a pickup truck. NASA's Deep Space Network is already monitoring many items in space, and the communication is both ways. So there's currently a lot of communication, and the Deep Space Network is getting bigger and bigger. If we plan to go to Mars and the Moon, they're going to have to make some dedicated additions to the Deep Space Network for communications there to be reliable. There's a single caveat to my assertion that Earth is not falling silent, and we owe it to Hedy Lamarr, the actress famous for going, "I want to be alone," when she invented spread spectrum technology. Yes, she was a scientist as well as an actress. This works by scattering your radio signal across numerous frequencies till it's indistinguishable from background noise. And unless you know the decoding key, you will never be able to reassemble the signal. If you transmit on spread spectrum, it seems improbable that aliens would decipher it. However, I cannot find any information on how much of our radar technology is using spread spectrum. And that's the one area I can't answer to. I looked, and if we start using spread spectrum, it seems to me would be much harder for aliens to detect it. But the idea that the Earth is falling silent is nonsense. I just want to see if I could kill one thing that's wrong in the public. Just curious if I could shut down that misconception that's been going on since about 1990, somewhere around there or earlier. Let's wrap this puppy up with even a further digression. Where are we going to go next with our exploration of space? Planetary defense, our innate human curiosity, and the search for extraterrestrial intelligence are now partners. We will seek to extend our passive and active searches in all three areas simultaneously. It is not possible to engage in one without inadvertently contributing to the other, particularly the SETI people, who are sort of like parasites to radio astronomers, or that cousin that suddenly invites himself along on your road trip. You can't shake these people. They want to find out everything you're doing and go, "Hey, that new telescope you built, can we use it for a bit?" So guaranteed, you can defund the SETI people and they'll be begging at your door. They're like stray cats. You feed them once with the little radio beacons and they're off to the races. So this is all now thoroughly mixed up and will remain so forever. Once we leave our backyard, where are we going to be? Well, we can already reach almost Uranus with radar. That is right. We have radar trained on Uranus. Beyond that, we have the Kuiper belt of comets that are nebulously swinging around the outer solar system along with that dismissed planet Pluto. But even further out, the solar system continues in the wonderful Oort cloud. It's theoretical. The donut around the solar system, the Kuiper belt, is real. We know that there's a sort of a torus of comets out there, but the Oort cloud is more of a, they seem to be coming from out there. And it seems to be spherically distributed, and it is monstrous. Some estimates, it's like getting a fraction of a way to another star. So these could even be interstellar clouds, but it's proposed at this point in time. The information on the Oort cloud seems to be that it's got a structure. And it's way out there. We're not going to be taking missions to the Oort cloud any soon. The Oort cloud is so far out there. At that point, you might as well go, why do we need to stop? Let's just go all the way to Disneyland at Alpha Centauri and reach the next star system. This would not be an undertaking to get there with our current craft. It would take centuries. So when I mean the Oort cloud is out there, it's out there. Why don't we try a ballpark exercise and figure out what we would need to create as a radar system to scan the Oort cloud. And this will give us a basic expectation of the kind of power our civilization would need to have at its disposal. And this would give us a basic expectation of the kind of power we will need at our disposal for our civilization to extend our cognition, our understanding of the universe further on. And given our history of increasing energetics of our explorations, it is not unreasonable to assume we might reach these values. There's a little bit that needs to be added to this, and that's the inverse square law that many people are familiar with, that if you back away from a radiant energy source, you double your distance from the sun, you don't get half the sunlight, you get a quarter. All you have to do is go, oh, I'm 3 times farther away, then it's 3 times 3, 9 times weaker. I'm 5 times farther away from the sun, then 5 times 5 is 25, it's 25 times dimmer. That does not apply directly to focused energy sources. And a parabolic dish is supposed to emit a parallel ray. And that ray will not diminish with distance because it's not spreading out. Laser beams are supposed to be the ultimate parallel energy source. Other effects will kick in beyond the inverse square law that will cause a laser beam to gradually spread. So getting a truly parallel beam is actually impossible, pretty much. But with the parabolic dish, you can narrow the beam or deliberately widen it. Could we send a beam out to pinpoint an object in space? Yes and no. You've done this with a magnifying glass when you try to set a fire. You try to get a pinpoint on your target. And you'll discover if your hand vibrates even a tiny bit, the circle that should be burning broadens and it doesn't work anymore. It is simply not practical to think we could focus the beam of energy on a target at ranges that are unimaginable. Can you imagine if I gave you a magnifying glass whose focus was a kilometer away and I said, burn that object, just hold your hand steady till you get a point on the object? It's not going to happen at those long ranges. The shaking of your hand will make it impossible to bring a pinpoint to bear. And it's not even theoretically possible. Parabolic dishes scatter their radar beam no matter what you do with them. And there's a simple formula called the half power beam width formula that is a simplified relation that indicates that the spread of the beam is 70 times the wavelength you're transmitting divided by the diameter of your dish. The 70 is a factor for efficiency. So I'm taking like our best theoretical dishes and we're going to see how big the beam would get. And the bigger the beam gets, the weaker our reception will be. We want to keep the beam tight. So let's do a pretend deep Oort radar concept, or DORC. And we are going to try to see what it would take to scan the Oort cloud with active radar. In all likelihood, we are going to passively detect the Oort objects using occultation. Not witchcraft, but the blocking of a source of light with an object. Voyager counted the rings of Saturn like that. And I've done it to avoid running over teenagers with my car. All teenagers in the springtime go through this phase where they go out walking at midnight in black clothing and they wander through the middle of the road and you're coming along and you could damage your car striking the teenage biomass. But if you're intelligent, you'll realize, hey, the distant street light flickered. Oh, there's something on the road between me and the street light. We're probably going to use passive techniques to find the Oort cloud objects because scientists don't get much of a budget, so they're excellent at finding cheats around expensive technology. But let's just say we decide to go for radar. This is what they're doing right now on Earth. This sucker is a couple million kilometers away, and it's only 2 kilometers across, and this is a radar picture taken from Earth. So we're really doing it. We're really reaching out into space with radar now, producing imagery that no telescope could match. So what can we do to come up with an estimate of a radar station that could reach the Oort cloud? Two ways I can think of right off the bat coming up with it. Reverse engineer the existing radars and going, well, if this radar at this many watts can take a picture of that asteroid, what could we do at an even greater range? And the other one is to calculate from first principles. Sit down with basic physics and compute what you need. Here is a release from Raytheon about their new radar system that is going to augment the Green Bank telescope system. So Green Bank will no longer just listen, it'll start knocking on doors. We are become space telemarketers, okay? And they are claiming they will have a 500 kilowatt radar in the Ka band that will reach Uranus. And that's enough for me to get a target size on this. I could find no further information than that, than those touchy-feely, you know, advertisements about like, and people like standing on hillsides and all this. But all I could find was this, 500 kilowatts, they can reach Uranus. Well, let's see what this would entail. Uranus is 20 astronomical units from the Earth, meaning it's 20 times farther from the Sun than we are. And we can image up to that distance and pick off asteroids with 500 kilowatts ground-based radar. The Oort cloud starts at 2,000 astronomical units away, making it 100 times further. Now, you might think this would mean 100 squared weaker reception. It doesn't. It's actually to the power of fourth, because unlike looking at a distant light source, radar is listening to its own echo. A telescope looks at the light coming from an object, but radar sends out the light and listens to its echo. So the radar beam spreads out by the inverse square of the distance, then it hits the target, which reflects that weakened energy, and it begins diminishing again on the way to you. So it turns out 100 times further from the sun means 100 million times weaker return signal. And so scaling things up, I get about 50 terawatts for the radar that could scan the Oort cloud. Now, how good do I think my estimate is? Oh gosh, it's terrible. I've only got 2 pieces of information from Raytheon, so I wouldn't even take a $5 bet that I'm within a power of 1,000, but we're getting ginormous amounts of radar would be necessary, which is but quite reasonable given the distance. Let's look at another fact that I can work back from. We're still communicating with Voyager 1. Whoever makes the air conditioners with their 90-day warranty and they last 91 days needs to talk to NASA if they want to make an appliance that will last. Like, I really think NASA should sideline between missions into making fridges and air conditioners, because these people know how to build a craft that lasts. I was a young boy when they launched it, and I'm frickin' dying of old age now, and this craft is still transmitting with a 23-watt signal. There are transport truck drivers who have a bigger radio, and we're still listening to it. So by my calculations, at 156 astronomical units away, the beam width is about 0.5 degrees. I computed 0.68, NASA says 0.5. The 4-meter wide dish then is throwing a cone of light, half a degree wide, which puts it at almost 2 astronomical units across when it reaches Earth. So the Voyager beam, despite being sent from a narrow source, it is now spread out to cover pretty much the distance from the sun to Mars. It's lighting up very dimly a good chunk of the solar system. But it's a lot better than if it was just a straight antenna. My calculations say we will be intercepting about 10 to the minus 23 watts per meter squared they're listening to on Earth. How close am I with that calculation? Well, I go to NASA, I go to the Deep Space Network, and I get the information from the Madrid Deep Space Station that's listening. and their claim is they are getting a signal strength of 10 to the minus 22 kilowatts. Not watts per meter squared, kilowatts. Watts per meter squared is what you're putting on per square meter. Their signal is telling you what the entire dish is receiving. The dish is 35 meters across, so when I compute the area of the dish divided into my intensity that I computed, I get we should be receiving a signal of 3.4 times 10 to the minus 19th watts from Voyager, and they're telling me 2.65. Okay? So that's like guessing my grocery bill. I guessed $34 and it was 26 cents and 50. That's a pretty darn good guess. And it's probably due to either my mathematical incompetence or the atmosphere and a few other factors. So I'm darn tight. I'm way tighter than I would have thought I could have been with my little estimate. Now we can work backwards. We know we can listen to a signal of 10 to the minus 23 watts per meter squared on Earth now. Maybe we can do better, but that's the best I can find by my calculations. So we need to work backwards to an Oort cloud object of 2,000 AU away. What kind of beam would we need to smack it with so it reflected a signal back to us as strong as Voyager? And this is going to be grim, because Voyager has the perfect shape to transmit a signal, a parabolic dish. The comet is the worst shape in the universe to send a signal back to us. It's a reflected ball. The signal is going to scatter. So it's going to be way weaker, even if it was sitting next to Voyager, just by that shape. When I work out what we need 10 to the 23 watts per meter squared reaching Earth. But remember, the snow cone in space is sending it out in a hemisphere, not a sphere, a hemisphere. It's spreading it out over space. And the amount of area that beam needs to paint in order for one little chunk of that paint to hit Earth at 10 to the minus 23 watts per meter squared is 27 megawatts. So that comet needs to light up with 27 megawatts of power in order for that tiny little sip to reach Earth. That's a lot of thing. And remember, that's not like us putting a 27 megawatt transmitter on it. We have to scream at it and get a reflection from our scream that's this intense. The beam is going to be powerful. So let's work it out. I'm going to imagine we put a 1 kilometer wide dish in orbit. I'm putting it at 3 gigahertz, which is right at the bottom end of radar, and I get a beam width of decimal 007. You go big on the antenna, you get a narrower beam, which seems to defy common sense, doesn't it? And what I work out with is this situation would allow us to hit that target comet 36 million kilometers wide with the beam. So the beam is big, but it's much tighter than Voyager's beam to Earth. But we've still spread the radar beam over 36 million kilometers by 36 million kilometers. And a big comet might be 50 kilometers across. Very little of that beam is going to echo. Realistically, what we're doing is we're going, echo! And you're hoping a ping pong ball 20 kilometers away in emptiness, you'll hear the returning echo. You're going to get very little echo back. So the beam reaches out to the Oort cloud, spread out over 0.2 astronomical units squared, and our comet will only intercept 5/10,000th of a billionth of the beam. And that's enough for us to calculate what we need to transmit at. If the comet is going to intercept that fraction of the beam, and that fraction of the beam has to be 27 million watts, let's multiply it up. This is like saying, can you imagine if there was 5 trillion people on Earth and you hand out $27 million to each of them? That's going to be a lot of dineros. We get 5 to the 10 to the 19th watts. It seems stupid at this point that we would want to receive this return echo, scream it out of a kilometer wide dish, and then listen to an echo at Madrid. If we're using a 1 kilometer dish to scream it out, why not listen with that dish? So I get 5 to the 10 to the 17th watts for our radar system. Now I got a problem. Using Raytheon, I get 10 to the 13th watts. Using my calculation, I get 10 to the 17th. That's a fairly big range, but it is a range, right? It's no worse of a range than some of the estimates of the size of the universe. I think it's 16 billion light years. I got close. I think it's 2,000 million billion light years. This happens. I don't expect this to be even remotely close to the answer. I expect it to be, could it be remotely possible, is what I'm after. And this turns out my worst case. We could build a telescope, but let's say we want to put it in orbit and solar power it. We would need, even with the most perfect solar panels imaginable, we would have a solar panel in the sky 20,000 kilometers by 20,000 kilometers of gathering sunlight to power this radar. I think you can say it's not going to be a priority. Just a real quick recapitulation of this. What if I boosted the size of the antenna by a factor of 10 and we decided to scan out to only 1,000 AU? Go, well, we can't afford to scan the Oort cloud, so do you want to do the lower budget one and scan empty space? Yeah, why not? Taxpayers paying for it. So if we set up a 10 kilometer orbiting dish, it turns out in the end, we'll be down to 25 gigawatts. And that would only require a solar array in orbit of 6 kilometers by 6 kilometers. Now quadruple that because that's life. So you could go to the moon, build a 10 kilometer dish, and then build 4 6-by-6-kilometer solar arrays, and then we're off to screaming at the Oort cloud. Now, how is it going to really look? Gosh, not the way I'm doing it. Someone's going to come up with a clever way. But what it shows me is civilization would be on the edge of commanding the energy to get radar signals back from the Oort cloud. And we're going to do it. There's like no way I can see it not happening for a simple reason. We always do that. We always want to go bigger and better. We're always curious. So sooner or later, we'll kick the strength up again. You don't think people in the 1930s could ever envision what we would do with our telecommunications technology. Therefore, the point I've been trying to make, and that I have beaten to death, is we are not getting quieter as a civilization. We are getting louder and louder and louder, and that's without even deliberately trying to be heard. We're like planetary children. Even when we're trying to be quiet, we wake our parents up. I want to see if I can actually prick the bubble on the silent Earth hypothesis. I want to see if I can bring to the end something I've hated since the day I heard it, that we're falling silent. I've never seen anyone substantiate that other than tabletop conversation over like a low and brow. Feel free to criticize me politely, because I'd love to get a dialogue going on this.